Welcome to my Toyota 200 series touring build. Here we are at episode 4 of my touring rig Toyota Landcruiser 200 series build mini series video series. This one is dedicated to drivetrain. And first, let's start at the front and talk about the motor. So this is a 2008 Toyota Landcruiser 200 series with the VDJ 200 V8 twin turbo diesel motor in it. This motor currently has 295,000 kilometers on the clock, and as far as the motor's concerned, is stock in every way. It still has the original injectors, and I even have the original airbox in it. Now, there's a big movement at the moment with people changing the original airbox out for aftermarket units because of stories of people dusting their motors. I think I'm one of the lucky ones. To date, I haven't had an issue with the original airbox. Now, I do have a couple of rules that I follow, which is if I open the airbox, I always make sure that I change the filter. I never open it, look inside it, and leave the same filter in it. I also always use rubber grease on the filter edge just to make sure that I get the ultimate seal. And to date, it's done me really well. After 2 trips to the Cape and countless trips out west, I haven't had any dust on the clean side of my airbox yet. So up the front, I have a Safari Armax snorkel, which I believe gives me 4 inches of breathing room down to the motor through that stock airbox. On the other side of the engine, I have a twin 3-inch redback exhaust system. Now, there's a lot of different exhaust options for these cars, and it took me a little bit to kind of cycle through and work out what I wanted. But the twin 3-inch all the way through is what ultimately sold me on this exhaust. It's also really well priced and it comes with a 10-year warranty. And when you look at the build quality underneath with 4-bolt flanges all the way through, you can see why they give it that 10-year warranty. Also, with 3 inches twin all the way through, this gives me effectively a 3-inch exhaust per bank of 4 cylinders and turbo, which I think is much better than the twin 3 into single 4-inch exhausts that a lot of people are selling these days. To complement the snorkel and exhaust, I had to get more power out of the motor, so I settled on a PowerCurve Performance ECU tune. Now, originally I had a Unichip Q4 plugged into the car with the multiple, I think it's 5 buttons that give me 5 separate tunes. I had 2 different people muck around with the tunes in the Unichip to try and get it right, but it just never felt correct to me. After speaking with the team at PowerCurve, they assured me that ripping that Unichip out and putting an ECU tune in was the best of all worlds. It could give me power and reliability when I was towing, when I was off-road, when I was just going down the highway. And to be honest, I haven't looked back since. Otherwise, under the engine bay, I have a Fuel Manager 30 pre-fuel filter kit, which just gives me that peace of mind when I'm out back fueling up, that if I get dirty fuel or water in my fuel, I'm completely protected. I also have a Harrop diff breather kit, which does my front and rear diffs, as well as my gearbox and transfer case. There's a little orange breather next to that, which is actually a breather that comes standard with my carbon series winch. The only stock parts under the engine bay that have ever let me down from Toyota is the stock intercooler and the stock radiator. The radiator cracked its top tank, which after it happened, I found out is a pretty common occurrence in the early model 200s. So a brand new radiator went in its place. The intercooler also started to leak a little while ago, and I've just been putting up with it until recently when I found a good quality secondhand intercooler to go in its place. On top of the new intercooler, I put a PWR twin thermo kit, which makes a huge difference when the car's driving slow and under load, such as driving in soft sand or when towing up steep hills. At first, I thought it was the transmission giving me these problems. I would stop for about 60 seconds, let everything cool down, and then the car would drive fine after that. But it turns out that it was simply the inlet air temperature was getting too hot. Putting these thermo fans on has completely fixed my problem, and I couldn't be happier with them. In terms of transmission, please don't cringe, but I have blown up a gearbox in this car. It was a long time ago when I first bought the car, and the car was pretty much stock standard, and we'd just bought our off-road van. We were towing near Barrington Tops National Park in New South Wales, and we came to this hill that sat at the bottom with massive signs, no towing, no trailers, no trucks. We decided to ignore that advice and up we went. The car got ridiculously hot. Now, we did make it all the way to the top, and when we got to the top, there was a slight decline that allowed us to just coast and let the car cool back down. Now, everything went fine. We got home, no worries at all. But about 3 months later, the gearbox started to play up. This was my first experience with the team at PowerCurve. I took the car to them when the gearbox was having some issues, and they did a complete service and said that they thought that there was something structurally wrong with the box. Based on this, I asked PowerCurve to help me find a secondhand box. And they were very, very quick at finding me a box that only had just over 40,000 kilometers on it from a wrecked vehicle. We threw that in, and we also put in an extra transmission cooler at the front of the car just to keep that gearbox as cool as possible. On top of all that, the PowerCurve team recommended that I went with a transmission lockup kit called a stock lock. And this has really changed the way the car drives when towing. It keeps my gearbox temperatures very, very low and ensures that I won't blow up another gearbox in the future. So now it's time to address a couple of questions that I'm sure you all have after seeing this video footage. The first being, why no catch can? Well, I've had an intake clean done on the car when it was about 200,000 kilometers through its life. And there was very little buildup in the intake at this point in time. To me, a catch can is just another thing that you have to worry about. In a trip that we did last year to the Cape, we did multiple water crossings and there was a car with us that had a catch can. Now, we found out after we had done a lot of water crossings that the catch can had actually filled up with water. We have no idea how this happened or if it's a common occurrence, but it's just another thing that you have to worry about. There are plenty of diesel motors out there that have no catch cans. And I'm sure there are lots of Toyotas out there with no catch cans that have no intake problems. If I have to do another intake clean in another 50 or 100,000 kilometers, I'm willing to do that, as long as I don't have to every 5,000 kilometers remember to empty my catch can. The second question I'm sure people are asking is, does the engine use oil, considering this is an early 2008 model Toyota Landcruiser 200 series? Short answer to that is yes and no. When I first bought the car, it had a full Toyota service history, and I continued to take the car to Toyota to have it serviced. Back in those days, the car did use oil. It used about 500 mil every 7,500 to 10,000 kilometers. Now, since I changed and started getting the car serviced at Opposite Lock and now more recently at PowerCurve, it stopped using oil. Now, I can't explain why. I'm assuming it's got something to do with the weight of the oil or the quality of the oil that is being used now, but I no longer have an engine that uses any oil, so that makes me very happy. So that's about it when it comes to the driveline of my 200 series. Now, I do have aftermarket brakes, but I'm going to leave that for a separate video. Otherwise, I have no air lockers, I run stock diffs. The CVs, as you can expect, have been changed once or twice, but everything else under the car is completely stock. The only thing I probably need to keep an eye on right now is the injectors. Now, I did have them checked about two services ago. They kept the car overnight and did a spec check when the car was cold in the morning, and the injector values all come back completely fine. This is something that I'm probably going to do every second or third service moving forward. I'm beyond happy with this car and the driveline that it has. The power, the economy, and most of all, the reliability has been top notch. I think it's really important for anyone out there to find a really good diesel mechanic, a really good auto electrician, and if you're going to have your car tuned, find a very reputable tuner. I've been very lucky because I live on the Sunshine Coast that I was able to find that all in one place at PowerCurve Performance, and I can highly recommend their services to anyone. Again, this is not paid or sponsored in any way. I just really have a lot of faith in what they do and the quality of their workmanship. So that's it for the driveline video on my 200 series. I'm sure there is heaps of questions and I'm sure there's heaps of tips that people will have. So please bang them down into the comments below. Now remember, this is only episode 4 of a 9-part series on my 200 series Landcruiser. If you want to watch all the other videos, please hit the subscribe button and also hit the notification bell so that you're notified as soon as a new video comes out. Thanks for watching, guys.